you. The music of my guest tonight has dominated the charts, the silver screen and the dance floor. Fusing European electronica and American R&B, he is credited with inventing an entire new genre, electronic dance music. Making the synthesizer the backbone of a whole new sound and collaborating with legendary soul diva Donna Summer, he created timeless and, dare we say, orgasmic classics like I Feel Love and Love to Love You, Baby. Moving to Hollywood, he went on to create groundbreaking film soundtracks, picking up Oscars for Midnight Express, Flashdance, and Top Gun, while topping the charts yet again with massive hits like Take My Breath Away, Call Me, and What a Feeling. Writer, composer, arranger, and producer, he's worked with artists as diverse as Barbara Streisand, Sparks, Phil Oakey, and David Bowie. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Disco King, Electro Maestro, and the Beethoven of the BPM, Mr. Giorgio Moroder.
Great to see you, Giorgio.
Thank you so much.
Were you talking about me?
I was.
Welcome to Talks Music.
Thank you, thank you.
Good to see you've got the tash back.
Yeah,
survived.
My wife convinced me, so I didn't shave yesterday, so I have the moustache back.
2013 has been quite a remarkable year for you, Giorgio. There you were enjoying kind of semi-retirement on the golf course with your wife.
Yes.
And you get a call from the biggest electronic dance act in the world, Daft Punk, to see whether you might collaborate on their new album.
Yeah, that was about 2 years ago. They asked me, we had lunch, and Thomas said, how about maybe one day if we have an idea for a song to collaborate, we just call you. So I was in Paris, and they called me, said, why don't you come to the studio and talk about your life?
My name is Giovanni Giorgio, but everybody calls me Giorgio.
The album becomes the biggest album of the summer, Random Access Memories, and your particular track on it becomes one of the most talked about tracks of the whole year. It's almost like a homage to yourself, Giorgio, and your body of work. Tell us a little bit about what it is that you did for that actual song.
Well, actually, I spoke for about almost 3 hours, and I didn't have a clue what they would do with my voice. At one point, I thought they may take pieces and make some, like, Moroder, you know, like the little things you could do. And I was talking to the engineer, and I was trying to bribe him. What did they do? He said, no, I'm sorry, we cannot tell you. And I think it was in March. They played it to me, and it was quite emotional, actually.
Once you free your mind about the concept of harmony and of music being correct, you can do whatever you want. So nobody told me what to do, and there was no preconception of what to do.
Was it strange to find yourself back in the spotlight?
Just slightly before this happened, I started to do a little bit of a DJ. So, but very small, so I had already a little bit the feel, oh, maybe a second career could start. And then in May, when the record came out, my whole life changed.
And you mentioned DJing. You've become a kind of very much in demand DJ. I think you described it somewhere as being a bit like Michael Jackson.
It is. I always wanted to be a singer, and not only a singer, but a famous singer. To be up there and you have 1,000 people, and that's what's happening now. I was in Mexico at a festival. There were probably 20,000 people, and it's like an ocean. It's beautiful.
So you're really enjoying it.
Oh, obviously. I love it.
And just before we go back to the early days, I heard that you might have plans for a big show in Vegas. Is this right?
The idea is this. The DJs, which are the kings of Vegas now, Calvin Harris and Skrillex and Tiesto, but the thing is, they have all those beautiful discotheques, beautiful, but they work from 12, 1 o'clock on at night. So before, in earlier, like, say, 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, the room is empty. So I thought, why not have a disco evening, maybe call it an evening with Giorgio Moroder, or just disco forever, and play only disco music. It would be absolutely fantastic.
Wow. Right, I'm going to take you right back. You were born in Italy. You then moved quite soon to Germany.
I left Italy when I was 19, and I had a little band, and we toured all Europe. I worked in Switzerland, in Germany, in Sweden, in Denmark, in Holland, France. Then I thought the life of a musician was great, but there's a time when you have to stop. And I always wanted to be a composer. So I ended up staying in Berlin for about 3-4 years, and then finally I went to Munich.
And early musical influences, Giorgio, who was having an effect on you in those tender young years?
Oh, when I was 15, 16, Elvis Presley was my... He was the best one, Elvis Presley. And then in the 64 or 63, when the Beatles came up, the Beatles were I knew almost every song, and they are the best ones. And then when I started to compose, I loved the bubblegum. There was a group called Ohio Express. Yummy, 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 I got love in my tummy. So I had a few songs in that style. Actually, I had quite a nice hit called Looky Looky, which was number one in France, in Spain, quite a nice hit in Italy. So that was my first record which came out and did okay.
And the music scene in Munich at that time, I have no idea what it was like. Just describe it, if you will, a little bit, Giorgio.
Well, at that time, when I came back from Berlin, I had already some hits, but nothing major until Pete Bellotti, my co-producer, and we found Donna Summer. And we had our musician, Keith Forsey, who is English, best drummer in the world, who then became producer of Billy Idol. We had Harold Faltermeyer on keyboard, who then became quite a big movie composer, had that famous Axel F. Dave King on the bass. So the Munich, kind of Munich sound, actually were those musicians. A very good steady drum, great guitar, great bass, and especially great keyboard.
Absolutely. Now, it's interesting. This era we're talking about now, kind of late 60s, early 70s, Giorgio, a very important time, wasn't it, really, in kind of German post-war kind of cultural history. And we were seeing, I mean, I remember, you know, hearing these kind of groundbreaking bands coming over from your neck of the woods, you know, like Cannes, Kraftwerk, Faust, Tangerine Dream.
Yeah, yeah.
And it felt like a kind of musical revolution in its own way.
I guess we all at that time discovered a synthesizer. I didn't have one, but I had a friend of mine, a classical composer, who I could rent it with his engineer. I went to hear whatever the classical composer did, and actually he just played me a low note, boing, in quarophonic. He was moving it, and it was beautiful, but, you know, after after an eternity of 2 minutes, it was getting a little boring. So then he left, and I said, okay, Tommy, that was the guy, the engineer, let me hear what this machine has. And he said, wow, you can do this, and you can play a bass. So I thought to myself, this is my instrument.
Giorgio, someone who had a huge effect on your career, and indeed you on hers, was Donna Summer. Tell me how you first met her.
We needed a three singers to do a sing on a demo, and one was Donna. We said whenever we have a good idea, we would call you. And I always wanted to do a sexy song, and I don't write lyrics, so I asked her, if you ever have an idea about a song, a sexy song, tell me. So she came back about a week later and said, oh, I have a song called Ooh, Love to Love You Baby, something like that. And I did a little demo. And my publisher went to Cannes, which they have a, it's called the MIDEM, which is a kind of a trade show.
Music festival, yeah.
And I was almost ashamed to give that tape because, you know, she started to moan and all that. She called me back 2 days later and said, everybody wants the song, everybody wants a song. So that was the start.
And so Donna actually wrote the lyrics for Love to Love You Baby.
The lyrics were written by Pete and Donna.
And Pete was, just explain Bellott, for the guys who Pete was.
Pete Bellott is an English guy who moved to Germany and he became my co-producer. She hated it. First of all, after having this big hit, we came to the States. I went with her the first time, and her parents were absolutely mad at her because they were so religious. And here the daughter starts to moan and all that stuff. So I think she sang it maybe the first 6 months, but she never... I don't ever know that she was singing it live.
Amazing.
Because she didn't feel comfortable.
I remember at the time there was quite a kind of moral backlash.
Yeah, in fact, the BBC didn't play it, which was great, because that was the best publicity we got. But I think later on they played it. I guess they had to play it.
Giorgio, if we can just talk about I Feel Love.
Right.
And Moby said it was the greatest dance record ever made, along with a whole host of other people who cited it as an influence, Giorgio. Can you just tell us a story of how that came about?
Okay, the idea was to have an album with sounds of the 50s, the 60s, and then the 70s. This was in 76. And so I thought, how could we have a song which would kind of reflect the future? So I thought maybe I'll try to use only a synthesizer, which is difficult because to create a bass line, that's relatively easy, but then a hi-hat and a snare and all that. So I took, for example, the hi-hat, I took a white noise, which is... You know, it's all the sounds together, and then cut them, trim them, and then obviously to play it, you need a click. You put a click on the 24 track, which then the click triggers the Moog.
Now, I understood a bit of that. what would be fantastic, Giorgio, is if you could just give us a little demo and talk us through that process again.
Yeah. So the first thing I did is I put down a bass. So after like half an hour, I was able to get one good sound, like dong. And then I had to do a kind of a loop, which was dong, 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 dong. So by triggering it from the click on the tape, it played dong, 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 dong. Well, let's see. Oh, one thing, the original was dun 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 dun, dun. And when we mixed it, by coincidence, the engineer added a delay, so it became.
Okay, That's brilliant. And that song goes to number one, 4 weeks in the UK.
It was great when Brian Eno took the record of 45, I guess, at that time, and went to David Bowie and said, David, I think I heard the sound of the future. Wow. That was...
What an accolade! You did a version of a song called MacArthur Park with Donna, which, I mean, raised a few eyebrows when it came out.
Pete Bellotti one day said, why don't we do a remix of MacArthur Park? And one day I was driving on the Hollywood freeway, and I think I heard it on the radio. I said, wait a second, who could do it? Obviously, who could do it? Donna Summer. I knew that this was a song which she could sing so well. The high note, and because the problem with Donna was that with Love to Love You, she was singing this high note, you know, and people thought, okay, yeah, she sings well that style, but she's not, probably not a really good singer. And then with MacArthur Park, we said, okay, now it's time to show the public how well she sings. At one point, a choir comes in, and that choir is me. I recorded every note 4 or 5 times, then the do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, si, all the notes. So I had a spectrum of probably 3 octaves, and I made loops, right, with a 24 notes sounds on a loop. And to play the chords, I would put the C major on 4 channels, so mix from the loop into the song by changing the channels. Which then later became, there was a machine called Mellotron.
Mellotron, yeah.
Mellotron, where you could play strings on a keyboard, similar thing.
Now, just so we get the timeline right here, in terms of where you were you still in Munich at this time, or had you gone west to
yeah,
LA?
So the Love to Love You came out, was a hit in the beginning of 76. But then Donna Summer wanted to go back
to Los
America.
Angeles.
Yeah.
You moved to LA, and somehow or other, you get involved in producing soundtracks for movies. How on earth, Giorgio, did you make the transition from being the genius behind Donna Summer and kind of creating disco to getting involved in Hollywood?
Well, first of all, Hollywood, as Hollywood in the movies, it is a closed group. All the composers come from classical background, and for somebody in the pop world to break in, now it's easy, but at that time was almost impossible. But then came Alan Parker, the great British director, and he loved I Feel Love. He said, that's the sound I want in the movie, Midnight Express, where at the beginning the guy escapes and he wanted something kind of dramatic. And he said, do whatever you want, but give me a piece which works in that scene. So I did The Chase.
Did you do this to pictures, or was it just a blank canvas?
No. I don't remember exactly, but I think I just started it with the tempo and which would work with the scene. And I remember the ending is where he runs and suddenly there's the guy with a gun. And I think we just did this. And it was done. So it was sync.
Thank you. Your first ever foray into movies, Midnight Express, what happens? You pick up an award for this.
I got my first Oscar, yeah. I was so nervous. Your stomach is up here, and when I went to the podium, I bumped into a light. And you have Steven Spielberg there, and you have
Jack Nicholson,
like with his smile, and you're up there. First time my English was not that great. It was Raquel Welch, and thank God Dean Martin was there, who helped me out with a little joke. And so I was safe. Oh, God, yeah, that was something.
Obviously, having picked up the Oscar, you were pretty hot property. Was the phone kind of white hot? Were directors ringing you up and asking you to come in?
I had two or three smaller movies, but the movie which I really loved was American Gigolo.
Okay.
With the song Call Me. Then I had a movie which didn't do well at the beginning, but now it's a huge cult movie called Scarface. And then...
We know it. Okay, let's just talk about Blondie and Debbie Harry and how that marriage came together.
I had the opening of the scene when Richard Gere, he drives down the freeway towards Malibu, and you see the wheels, and he's driving, and the wind, and the music comes in, and it worked so well. So I put a very little demo right there. 3 weeks ago, when I met Deborah in Mexico, she said something like, "I could blackmail you." I said, "Why? What's wrong?" Okay, I still have the cassette which you gave me of the song, with me singing, with a guitar, and I don't even remember that, but she said, and the lyrics you sang were something like, love machine, sex machine, because he was a gigolo. So I didn't know my was, instead of call me, I said, love machine, something like that. Thank God she changed it.
The next movie we find you involved with, Georgie, was Flashdance. It also picked up another Oscar. And I think a Golden Globe as well.
Two
Golden Globes.
Yeah, best music and best song.
Did you think when you were doing the music for that particular movie that this was going to be another Oscar winner?
Okay, the story behind Flashdance is that Jerry Bruckheimer, the producer, had a movie before called Doctors in Love, which was not a porno, but that kind of, it was a soft, very soft. And then the word came out that he's doing Flashdance, and nobody knew what Flashdance means. So I thought, oh God, if this is a little soft something, like I don't know if I want to get involved. So at the beginning I said, no, I think I have to pass. Then he asked me again, and I said, okay, when the movie's done, send me the tape and I'm going to watch it. So I didn't even want to watch it because I was doing some other stuff. And so I gave it to my then girlfriend and she played it while I was in the studio at home. And so when the movie was over, she came in and she was crying and she said, oh, the best movie. Oh, it's so beautiful. And it is a movie for females, right, I guess. She was crying and I said, okay, I'll do it. Yeah, this is probably my favorite song. It has a good melody. The structure is good. Irene Cara sang it beautiful. The lyrics are good. The arrangement, and it fitted so well the movie.
Can we just talk about Top Gun? Writing a song about fighter pilots and superpowered Navy jets, what direction were you given beforehand?
At the beginning, I was not involved at all. Harold Faltermeyer started the score, and they did a recording of the score and the music in my studio, and Jerry Bruckheimer was there. And he said, "Oh, Giorgio, we're doing Top Gun. Why don't you write a song for us?" Oh, so I said, I can write something. So I did a little demo of Take My Breath Away with a, this, that's another interesting story, with my lyricist, whose name is Tom Whitlock, who came to the studio a year before. Because I had a Ferrari, and he came in and said, "You know, I see you have a Ferrari out there. I'm a mechanic. Can I come in once in a while and adjust it?" And I said, yeah, why not, if it doesn't cost too much. One day he came in and said, "Oh, by the way, I'm a lyricist. If you ever need lyrics, if you ever need lyrics, call me." One day I needed lyrics for a demo, and he came in and wrote the lyrics. Not Top Gun, but before. One or two songs which became little smaller hits. Yeah. And so he wrote the lyrics for Danger Zone and Take My Breath Away.
My goodness. So this is a guy who was your mechanic.
Mechanic.
And ends up writing one of the biggest songs of all time.
Yeah. And he won the Oscar too. Well, we won, yeah.
This is getting repetitive, isn't it? The girl who sang Take My Breath Away was a girl called Terry Nunn.
Terry Nunn.
From Berlin.
Yeah. Sometime when you have a hit for a movie, for example, Call Me, I loved it, Deborah loved it, but the group didn't. Because the group, that was a punk group, like, so whenever they had to play Call Me, because it was the song which everybody loved, they were all, I'm almost say pissed, right? The same with Berlin, because Berlin was a group, kind of a punk group too, and she came out as a singer with Take My Breath Away, which was totally different from what they would sing usually. It didn't fit in their
normal repertoire.
Yeah.
So three Academy Awards, I mean, that's pretty impressive. If you had to choose one of them, the one that you're most proud of, what would it be?
The first one, because it kind of not only got me in the business, but it worked so well with the movie, and it created a new sound, so I think that's my favorite.
Now, amongst the many movies which you've been involved with, the one which I remember at the time reading about this, and it seemed to me to be an incredible project to take on board, was Metropolis. A classic black and white silent movie, yeah. Which you set about creating a soundtrack for it, but also kind of rescuing the movie.
Well, we had a ton of problems. First of all, to buy the rights, it cost a fortune. The next problem was there was no good copies of it. The owners didn't have any good one, which is kind of unusual, right? They are asking a fortune to license it, but they don't give you the stuff. So I researched and I found an old cinema on La Cienega in Los Angeles. There was a movie theater where they have the owner was still playing silent movies. Very old guy, I guess he was 90. And so I asked him, "Can you find me some Metropolis?" And he went, you know, all a stack of films, not in the box, just laying there, and he found one. He said, okay, here it says Metropolis. So I took it, I put it in the car, and I went to CFI, the big company in Hollywood who does all the prints. And I gave it to them and said, are you crazy? This is pure nitrate. It's pure explosive. You know, yeah, because with heat and movement, we could have exploded.
Why the fascination with rescuing this film?
First of all, this movie, nobody ever saw the movie because there was not even a copy you could decently present to somebody. So to rescue it, to get it out, and especially I thought with the right music, I could get some younger people to watch it too. People who don't even know what silent movie is, right? If I ask my son who is 24, silent movie, that doesn't exist, right? So that was the idea.
And one of the most memorable tracks from the movie was with Freddie Mercury.
Freddie was a little difficult. He was not an easy guy to work. But he was so talented, so incredible mind and great pianist, and he knew exactly what he wanted. So there was a little bit of a conflict. I wanted it slightly different.
Who won?
Well, he won, actually. Yeah.
Somebody else you worked with was Phil Oakey from Human League.
Phil Oakey, very nice guy. Oh, by the way, yeah, that was the movie Electric Dreams.
Together in Electric Dreams.
Electric Dreams.
Yeah. What was it like working with Phil?
It was very easy. He's a great singer. He knew the song.
It's an interesting choice to go for somebody like Phil Oakey. What was it made you choose him?
It was more the producer who loved the group. Most of the time, it's not me who decides. It's the producer or the director.
You just got to make it work.
Yeah.
Now, as if inventing a new genre of music, picking up 3 Academy Awards and a heck of a bunch of other awards for soundtracks, as if that wasn't enough, you've also been involved, Giorgio, in writing songs for the Olympics.
The first song I did was for the Olympics in 84 in Los Angeles. Then in Seoul in 88, asked me to write the theme for the Olympics there. I wrote that song literally in a restaurant. By the way, I don't write music. I know where C is, but I don't write. But the melody I came out was da 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 da, hand in hand da da. And before I forget, I wrote mi re do re mi, something like that. And I wrote it down on a piece of paper so that I wouldn't forget it.
And this was in a restaurant?
In a restaurant. So
before the starter, the main course, or the dessert?
It was after the coffee. The next one was the Olympics in Beijing. And that was a little confusing because nobody really knew who is in charge. But I had a great song, and Beyoncé wanted to sing it. So the week before we were ready to go in the studio, Steven Spielberg, you know, he was supposed to work on the opening ceremony of the games, and he canceled it because there was this whole problem with Sudan and Chinese helping the rebels. I don't know exactly. So image-wise, he didn't want to get involved with the Chinese, and Mia Farrow was one who said, Steven Spielberg, you cannot go to China or to some other guy. You cannot go. And that's when Beyoncé called up and said, look, I would love to do it, but I cannot do it. So I did it. I did a song with some great Chinese singers, and it did well, very well.
But Beyoncé was obviously a fan because she, of course, has sampled Love to Love Me, Baby, hasn't she?
Well, actually, she sang it.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's a
song called Naughty Girl, which was a good song, and obviously my part was the best.
Yeah. There's a quote from you which I read back in the archives saying, it was back in the 70s, saying that you thought the synthesizer was the sound of the future. What would you say is the sound of tomorrow now?
If I knew, I wouldn't tell you. Because otherwise you would do it. No, I don't know. I don't know. I think the sound for now, not the future, but the sound for now, and that's what I'm doing, is go back to the real good live instruments, especially bass drums, guitar, Fender Rhodes, and real violins.
Back to real music and real guitars, real drums.
Yeah, because the guitarists give you ideas. That's why with my guys in Munich, Harold Faltermeyer and those guys, they helped me so much creating not only sounds, great sounds, which we had, but melodies, counter melodies, arrangement, and you feel it right there. You know, okay, this works.
Okay. At this point in the program, we do a little section called Single File. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to ask you a single question. And if you can, you've got to try and answer with a single answer.
Okay.
Yeah? A single sentence. Okay. Who was or is your single most influential artist of all time?
I would say the Beatles. I love them. The Beatles are the best.
Which album, Giorgio, are you proudest of?
I love Midnight Express because it was so new and was my first.
Which new artist do you find the most exciting?
I love the DJs who create new stuff, like Skrillex, for example. What a guy. He's a genius. And Calvin Harris. I love dance music anyway.
What was the single hardest lesson you ever learned?
I made the biggest mistake of my life. I sold my publishing rights.
Ouch.
You know, at that time, publishing rights, the song, you know, you had a song and you would make nice little money, but this was like 20 years ago, and now the songs are played in license to movies, to TV, to commercials. It's a whole new life, right? And I've sold them. But I still compose, so I still have new ones.
Which single event changed your life forever?
Oh, that's easy. That is when I overslept on purpose, instead of getting up at 8, going to do the exam to become a geometra, which is a kind of an architect. On purpose, I didn't wake up so that I could become a musician. Because just a week before, I got the offer to play in a group as a professional musician, and I said, I have to go. So if I would have passed the exam, I would still be probably, my mother would never have let me go. So I, on purpose, didn't go to the school.
Now, this is time for me to have a little bit of a rest and turn to our audience. Our audience is made up of students from various music colleges, and I think we've got some questions that you're burning to ask.
Hi, my name's Laura Swiss, and I wanted to know, when you were trying to get into the music industry, did you ever struggle to find motivation? And also, were you ever worried that you weren't going to make it?
I was lucky with my first song. Literally, my first song was a hit. So I was lucky. But No, today's it's easier and more difficult. At my time, it was difficult to make a good demo because, you know, a demo costs money. Now, with a technology, with $2,000, you have a little recording like this one with a little mixer microphone, and you could do absolutely perfect, great songs. And then you can launch them now through all the social, which we didn't have. And if there are ways to promote it, well, you do a little video which costs nothing, right? You go into YouTube and all Vivo and all those, and if the song is good, you have a good chance.
Another question, please.
Hi, I'm Connor Hugh, and my question was, if you could go back in time and meet yourself before you were, you know, well established in the music industry, what advice would you have to give to yourself?
I would say, be careful what you sign, because I remember one of my biggest signing, which I still regret, was the guy tricked me in with a coffee. We were talking, and oh, we can do this. And then he gave me a big coffee and a lot of Cointreau and drinking, and I was getting happy, and he was promising this, and I signed the contract right there, which was not good. And plus, who you sign with, like managers, sometimes are not always your best friends, so...
So get a lawyer.
Yeah, but a good one.
A good lawyer.
A good one, because my lawyer at that time was not good, so...
Hi, Giorgio. My name's Jane Walker. My question is, from the top of your head, how many babies do you think were conceived to... love to love you, baby.
My personal was one. my personal... The song created, what, I would say a few million?
Yeah, few million.
A few, right.
A few million.
Yeah, well, the song was a hit in China, so probably. And especially in the north, where the winters are long and cold.
But I want to say, on behalf of myself and everybody here today, you have been one of the most generous guests we've had on the show in terms of sharing your advice, and I have to say, one of the most humble. Thank you so much for coming here today and talking music.
Thank you.